make a case for people who say that the invest in education measure, which would tax the wealthiest Arizonans, make the case that it's not unfair. And we'll start with you, Ms. Hoffman.
Well, I do support the Invest in Ed initiative because it is about time that our schools have a steady, stable, reliable source of revenue for our schools. We've been far too reliant on regressive taxes like the 3.0 Prop 301, which is a sales tax. And so I do think that we should have lots of support for this going forward because it would bring our education funding back to 2008 levels. I think it is a good thing that it, by and large, our middle class and low-income families would not be affected by this tax. And at the end of the day, it's all about putting resources back into our schools for our students, making sure that one of my priorities is to make sure that we do have all the support staff there in our schools, as well as, of course, highly qualified teachers. But the school cannot run without our support staff, without the classified staff. And we also need to make sure that, like, as I said before, that we have the counselors and the social workers and that the entire school is fully supported. I've also worked at a school that did not have full day kindergarten. And it's just astonishing to me that we still have schools that just have 2.5 hours per day of kindergarten when we know that early education is so important for building those social skills, building relationships with peers, and starting to have that exposure to literacy. And so I feel very strongly that the schools need this money.
But again, the fairness argument you mentioned, again, it's a good thing it's not hitting the lower income and middle mm-hmm. income people. That's exactly the argument framed in a different way that will be used to defeat it. Is it fair?
My personal opinion is that it is fair. We also know that the way it's structured, so a couple who is earning $500,000, it's going to only affect, someone earning over $500,000, it's only going to affect their income that's over that. So it's not affecting their entire income. And I do know there's going to be lots of arguments about, we shouldn't just tax one part of our community, but I do think that when we have had regressive taxes, such as the sales tax, it's been an unfair burden on our lower income and more middle class families. And so I do think that by bringing it back to 2008 levels, we are making a more fair tax system, and we do need to find that money somewhere.
Again, Mr. Shapira, the fairness argument in Invest for Ed.
Yeah, first, there's a lot of misconceptions about how InvestNet is structured. And let me just be clear, InvestNet is critical. It needs to pass in November if we're going to end the teacher crisis in our state and ensure that our kids, my kids, and the next generation of kids in the state have the opportunities they deserve. I did a video with Josh Buckley, who's the chair of that initiative, that's available on my Facebook page, which explains how it works. Facebook.com/David4AZ, David F-O-R-A-Z. You can go back and watch that video where we talk about what Kathy just mentioned, where a lot of people don't understand marginal tax rates. They don't understand that you're only taxed the higher rate on the amount of money you make over $500,000 as a couple or over $250,000 as an individual. So there's no disincentive to make more money, which is one of the arguments that's out there. One of the other arguments that's out there is that it will double the tax rates on the highest income folks in our state. Richard, literally nobody's taxes will double. Literally no one, because that's just not how marginal tax rates work. They will still pay the same rate on the first $25,000 as everybody else in the state pays. And even if the rate on the income they have over $500,000 increases to almost double, that still doesn't even quite double, it will not increase anyone's taxes double on their income taxes. Let's be clear, in the 1980s, and you may remember this, Richard, when I was a kid and I was in school.
That sounds like an age crack.
Yeah, well, it's not, because I was around the 1980s in Arizona too. When I was a kid, when I was in school, and the viewers out there may not believe this, those who haven't been here that long, Arizona was above the national average in per student spending. Arizona was seen as a national leader in education. We attracted and retained teachers out of our three state teacher prep programs, three of the best in the nation, and they still are. But now we lose them to other states or lose them to other professions because not only because of compensation, but because of working conditions and because of a lack of respect from our state capital. In the late 80s, 1987, they started cutting the taxes on corporations and the highest income folks in the state. What InvestNet does is it sets their tax rate back roughly to what it was in 1987. The last thing I'll say about this, which is important and it's complicated, I'm a math teacher, so I'm gonna use visuals as best I can with gestures. We need the whiteboard, right? But what people don't understand is because Arizona is so overly reliant on sales tax and property tax, which, as Kathy mentioned, are regressive taxes. Because we're so over-reliant on those things, it is actually the lowest income folks in Arizona who pay the highest share of their income in property sales and income taxes combined into the state coffers. It is the highest income folks who today in Arizona pay the lowest percentage of their income into state and local taxes. InvestNet would bring some equity to that situation.
We should have brought the blackboard and whiteboard. I'm going to give you a chance to respond and also get Mr. Schapira prepared mentally for his closing statement, because we're almost home. Yes, you're. Is InvestNet the answer for education funding? And where should Arizona rank in a dream scenario as far as per student spending?
Well, I think it's important to mention here also that the role of the superintendent is not to determine the taxes or the tax rates for the population of Arizona. This is still the responsibility of our legislature and our governor to pass the budget to determine exactly where the money should come from. It is our role to, as superintendent, would be my role to say what our priorities should be and what our schools need. And so, for example, since we're talking about salaries and money and making lots of talking about math a lot, I want to point out that over the past decade or even more, while the teacher salaries have stayed completely stagnant, the cost of health insurance has gone up. And another thing that many people do not realize is that our teachers do not have any paid maternity or paternity leave. This often comes to a shock as people. Yeah, I see your eyebrows going up. They don't. And so they are covered by FMLA to take 3 months off. It is completely unpaid. And during that time, it is an extreme economic hardship for most families, unless they have a high income earner partner to help support them. But it is very difficult to have a newborn and to go through a very expensive process of having a new baby and welcoming that baby into the family and to not have that support. So I do believe that by providing our teachers with adequate and good health care and paid maternity and paternity leave, that will actually make the teaching profession more attractive to young people who are in college, who are interested in becoming teachers, but they're looking for jobs with good benefits. And they're looking to take care of their families. They're worried about paying off their student loans. And that will also help us retain our highly trained, qualified teachers. So it is a very important issue.